Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen, to all of our viewers wherever around the world that you are. Welcome to the Robert Christian Show. I'm your host, Robert Christian. Joey Shane, our co-host. He is taking a brief hiatus away from the show so he can get some other work done. Nonetheless, folks, the show must go on. I'm looking at some of the news that we are following. A Jersey group claiming to represent a quarter of Jersey churches says that gay couples should not be allowed to get married. Apparently it leaked a draft letter. Jersey Evangelical Alliance has asked church members to oppose same-sex marriage ahead of the July the 1st debate. Isn't that something? Well, we'll see how far that gets them. Four same-sex couples were married in the office of the St. Louis, Missouri Mayor Francis Lay on Wednesday. That is interesting, allowing gay people to be married in Missouri. However, it hasn't gone before the court system there in Missouri as yet. Maybe we'll get into some of that with our guest today. Former U.S. President Bill Clinton, signaling that the Defense of Marriage Act, or signing, rather, the Defense of Marriage Act into law back in 1996, he says apparently was seen as a major betrayal to the LGBT community, is what he's now saying, that had supported his being elected to begin with. 17 years later, key provisions of DOMA, if you've been following it, as I have, but key provisions, however, were gutted by the U.S. Supreme Court, which made it possible for the federal government to recognize same-sex marriages. Clinton then says that he has changed his views. Isn't that a little entertaining? Gays who were consulted from a religious leader are more likely to attempt suicide than those who sought no treatment at all for being gay, according to this news report. A study has also revealed the Williams Institute has found that LGB people, not the T people, but the LGB people, received therapy from medical professionals were less likely to attempt suicide, than those who did not seek help. But assistance from faith-based counselors were associated with higher risks of suicide. I have a question for our viewers. Do you think that faith-based prevention or therapy, that is going to be enough to solve the problem with gay people in America? What do you think? Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show. Don't go away. We will be right back.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show.
And we welcome everybody to The Robert Christian Show. Good day, everybody. And I do want to say a special shout out to everybody. Reminding everyone, before I forget and before I get too topsy-turvy with today's show, and it will be one of those shows. On July the 11th, we are having This Is Awesome. For those that live in California, we are having Nicholas Wildstar on at 3. He is running for the office of governor in the state of California. And he does stand on a lot of very unique, very interesting subjects, as well as his support for the LGBTI communities there in California. Chef Brandon returns on the 18th. Yes, he does. And we also have a CEO, Judith, right? Yes. From a drug rehab facility there in, I believe she's also in California, coming on the 25th. Oh, Lord, let us see what else is going on. We have a Eva Gantz, an LGBTI writer, book author, coming in on the 29th, and of course on August the 1st, voila, David Bryant, the author of the book series entitled 15, is going to be our guest. Meanwhile, we have Roger Winters with us again today. Hello, Roger. It is great to see you again.
Great to see you, Robert.
You know, it has been a long time, Roger.
A few months, anyway.
And we have had, oh my gosh. You know, back in May, Roger, we did every show that we did, it was the month of June. Every show in June was on the T and LGBT. We had a lot of transitional stories. Young lady, well, her story made the news. It actually did. In her transition, she is going through her final surgery in the next week or two, is what she's doing. Let's see, who else do we have? It's interesting, a blast from the past. Renee. No, that was in May. Anyway, folks, we've had our schedule full. oh my God, I need a freaking booking agent. Roger. So, hey, we're talking about Stonewall today. The anniversary of Stonewall is tomorrow. This is going to be a subject, Roger, that is going to have a lot of people talking, especially this weekend with Pride events in Seattle this weekend. I'm sure of other Pride events around the country are also happening at the same time, concurrently to what has happened in Stonewall and the anniversary of it. How would we begin looking at the events in and around Stonewall?
I think Stonewall was a watershed, a tipping point, an important event, not because of just what happened there alone, because what led up to it, what it represented, and what it meant, has meant to us since, as a symbol of a large effort in this country to bring liberation to a whole lot of people.
Well, you know what? I think that we need to have a very liberated society. That goes without saying. We were talking a year or so ago about same-sex marriage and the battle. Once that the U.S. Supreme Court made their final decision, their call, and now here we have the Supreme Court saying, yes, what's the big deal? And now the states are still battling this out, not necessarily at the ballot box either, but to try to find out, you know, is the bans on same-sex marriage alone, is this constitutional or unconstitutional? And they're finding, to the contrary, that it is unconstitutional. Now, I bring that in, Roger, into the issue with Stonewall for this reason, because just prior to Stonewall, and even during Stonewall, for those that would like a little history lesson, it used to be illegal from the report that I read, anyway, as of this morning, it used to be illegal, Roger, for men to dress in women's apparel.
Mm-hmm.
And now, wasn't this right in there with Stonewall?
Yes, it was. And in fact, I think there were certain rules about how many items a person could have on his person that were typically belonging to the opposite sex. Before he would cross the line and therefore be arrestable. But being arrested was a fairly commonplace experience for our people at that time and before that time. The kind of condition of our lives that a few of us remember, and a lot of younger people don't know anything about.
So what would you say to them beyond get educated?
Well, we can educate them a little bit. They need to understand that the freedom they enjoy today and the happiness that they're able to access today is to a great degree conditioned on a long effort by other people to break down social and political oppression of homosexuals drag queens, anyone who was on the fringe of ordinary behavior in society. You know, I grew up in a time when everything was going to be father knows best kind of households. And we would all follow the same rules and follow the same morality and all aspire to the same things. We sang the same songs. We had a sort of solidarity as a society. It was even more so before I was born, before the world wars occurred. People would go to the movies and they would watch, follow the bouncing ball and sing together. And they would get their news together and they would socially connect, but over a very limited pattern of behavior. And there was very little room for same-sex affection, love, sex, any of that. If it happened, it happened sporadically. It happened, and it got different kinds of responses, perhaps in different places, but many responses were very negative. And then came the World Wars, and what happened there? Men and women left their homes on the farm, and they went into the factories, they went into the service, they went abroad, they were put together with units of their peers, and they got to know people from all walks of life. And that meant that a lot of gay people, just to use the term in general, met each other for the first time from different places, and they had new attitudes about that, and about the value of the connections that they were building with as friends, as people in foxholes who were facing death together, who were having a really important experiences together as they fight to make the world safer to democracy. Well, that really was a revolutionary change in American society, because before the wars, people largely didn't leave the farm and go more than 25 miles away from their birthplace in the course of their entire lives. And now they were world travelers. They had seen foreign lands. They had, you know, many brought home wives or married into married people from other countries. And the world was really going to change. And we even saw the desegregation of the army by President Truman after the war. By an executive order. These are earth-shaking changes in America at the time, because desegregation was not a popular notion at the time. Hardly anyone even heard of the idea. It seemed natural to have segregation of the people of color, the white people, clear and simple. It sort of went without saying. And homosexuality was only a vague background kind of phenomenon. You heard whispering about queers and whispering about those people, or some sort of mysterious shadow people who were dangerous, preyed on children, or dressed in women's clothes or something like that.
What do you feel, maybe looking back at it now, that there were more people back then that were literally living in the closet, or do you find more people today living in the closet than back then?
Well, the closet is, to me, not a bad concept. The closet is what protects you from a hostile society. And maintaining the closet is something I always respected in other people. I don't take it on myself to say, you should break down your closet. But I do encourage people to come out. I do encourage people to embrace the freedom and liberation that exists there for them if they will do that. And I think more and more people have come out, and we have seen a real blossoming of self-identity as LGBTQI identity, and life, not just a lifestyle, but who you are and how you want to structure your life. And it's your own choice. And this is a matter of freedom. It's adult stuff. It's saying, I'm going to be who I want to be. And I've often said in the course of our movement, I said, you know, we're the ones making the world safe for diversity. And it's the diversity that America couldn't tolerate before that has started to percolate throughout society and people recognize it as the positive value that it is. But even so, we still find people will, at the case of any pride parade, somebody is going to object to this group or that group over there, and the, you know, the press will cover them, and I'm not like them, and I don't like that, and so forth. We all kind of have our identities and sub-identities within this vast community.
Now, why is it, I've seen this, I've heard it, people saying, gay people, all right, they can turn it on and they can turn it off like a light switch.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to be that way. They could choose to be this other way.
Mm-hmm.
How is that either an oxymoron or possible?
Well, it is possible to hide the fact that you're gay if you don't have a stereotypical personality or way of expressing yourself. Just an anecdote from college. I had my sophomore year, half a dozen of us were good friends in the dorm. It turned out all of us were gay except for one boy, and he was effeminate, had long hair. He was the one bold enough to wear his hair like the Beatles in the year the Beatles came to America. And people chased him down the dorm to try to cut his hair. He was straight. The rest of us were gay. And it came out in the course of the year, but it took a while for us to break that down and realize that's why we were attracted to each other. We liked each other as people because there was that bond. We weren't sexual, all of us, with each other or anything like that. It was just a matter of affinity, closeness, and discovery, and mutual support. But we all had to keep each other's secret still. We all had to pretend out in the world of our dorm and our campus and our classes, because we could lose careers, we could lose our lives, we could lose our nose, broken bones or something, if we were exposed as gay. But the history, I think, of Stonewall and what happened there is like a person coming to realization of, I can't live that way anymore. I can't put up with that kind of treatment by society anymore. In fact, I'm going to stop putting up with it. I'm going to resist it. I'm going to defy it. I'm going to stand up against it. I don't care what the consequences are. And that was really a very bold position to take. But we were at the tipping point of doing that throughout America, at least at that time. I was in Boston in those years. I went to a gay bar that had police coming in for their payoffs on party nights. We lived in a society in Massachusetts where sodomy, that is any sex we did, was a 14-year penalty, potentially, in prison. Not in Uganda, but in Massachusetts. And so you could be arrested by this guy you're taking home with you from the bar because he's so sweet and nice. And out on the street he says, I'm arresting you for solicitation. And so there was all of this sense of fear in the background. My goodness, this would get me kicked out of my graduate school, or I'll never get a teaching job or whatever if I'm exposed to this. This was intimidation. It was the culmination of ongoing intimidation that's gone on for centuries. And you can only imagine what it was like for people who didn't have any institutions or places to go to be themselves, but who were, like us, sexual minorities, people of all walks of life, of the whole spectrum of the Kinsey scale, if you will, and who wanted to find self-expression and fulfillment and love that fit them. And to be able to do that with freedom was just unheard of throughout most of society.
How old were you, Roger, when Stonewall was going on?
Stonewall was when I was 24 years old.
24. So you're old enough to remember before Stonewall and surely after.
Yes.
Now, would you say, and I read a very interesting news tabloid about Stonewall from back then. Well, it wasn't dated from back then. But anyway, the tabloid, the interesting news story, it was talking about it, and it more or less summed it up, Stonewall, that is, and said, look, it was more or less a firestorm that just spread, more or less, because of what happened then, the police raids, as they came into to Stonewall, into this place, into this establishment, and said, guess what, we're here to take it over. What do you think of that now?
Well, it was, again, intimidation was routine. They did it a lot. They come into the bar, turn the lights on, say, okay, everybody, line up, get your IDs out, we're going to take you downtown, book you for disorderly conduct or some such bullshit, and then, you know, then you can go on your way. Just behave yourself, you won't have any trouble. You don't behave yourself, you get into, you know, trouble with us, the cops. And on this particular night, people said, we're not going to take this anymore. Let's push these sons of bitches out of our bar. Let's get them out of here. And that created a ruckus that started to draw attention from the Greenwich Village community, and people gathered around the bar, and they began taunting the police. And it grew, and over the course of several nights, this confrontation between police and people who were customers at a bar, they knew that people at bars all over America could go and drink and socialize and be with their friends and not even be concerned about the police coming through and just arresting them all for being there, for being who they are, and being able to intimidate them because they're just out socializing. So why couldn't we? Well, some of it was these guys want to wear women's clothing. Some of them do. Some of these people are outrageous, and they defy the normal values of the society, and we can't let them get away with that kind of thing. We've got to assert our authority. This is a sickness at best, a crime, and you know, and so forth. Bars were often run by the mafia, or some other criminal syndicate that's profited from our need to socialize, and they paid off the police, and they paid off, you know, corruption was commonplace. Here in Seattle, the Queen City Business Guild, which became later the GSBA, but during the 60s and 70s, they were upset about being constantly at the mercy of police seeking payoffs, bribes, in order to not hassle their establishments. Just a few blocks from here in Pioneer Square, they got the news out that that was happening, and they were courageous to do that and to say this city doesn't have to tolerate that kind of behavior by its officials. And it's a turn of the mind that says, hey, I don't deserve this anymore. I thought I did, maybe. I thought maybe I was sick, twisted. Jesus didn't love me. God hates me, or whatever, because that's what I've been told all my life. But you know what? The people that I've met and the feelings that I have with regard to my community of people or friends are good, positive feelings, and I think there's nothing wrong with that. I'm going to stand up and say, I'm entitled to dignity. I'm entitled to equality. I'm entitled to being myself according to my choices, and you can't keep forcing me away from that. That's very liberating point of view, and it's very scary also, because you don't know if you're going to win or be destroyed.
Well, you know, I know that when the raids and all of this were going on there in Greenwich Village of New York, I can't say that the whole world was watching, but surely the message did get around. Mm-hmm. And today, we look at Stonewall and the anniversary of Stonewall, and you know, I really wish, Roger, that it was that it happened a bit differently, rather than that beginning due to a raid of sort, but rather people getting together and saying, guess what, this is who that we are, this is our makeup, you know, this is it, this is me, this is who I am, It is a part of me.
In 1968, something happened in Boston that I participated in that was quite refreshing in its way. I was invited to join a group of gay men in a restaurant in the banquet room, which was upstairs in the windowless attic of the restaurant, and for breakfast one Sunday. And we were going to socialize and then have a guest speaker. And we had two meetings that I attended. One was had a doctor present to talk about venereal diseases and what to do about that and how the state reported on them and, you know, tracks contacts and stood possibly to embarrass you if you had happened to be reported as having such thing. But then also an attorney to advise us about what happens if you get caught and you're up against the law for the crime of sodomy or the crime of solicitation. And their advice was largely try not to get caught, but if you do, then try to get a good attorney. You're going to have real problems from that situation, and be prepared for those consequences. After a couple of meetings, as I understood it, the restaurant owner was very nervous about having a group of homos in his establishment, even though they were assembling peaceably, like the Constitution says, and they were in his, you know, windowless room. And so no one really could notice what they were doing. And these were men who were out to meet other men, and they were not, it's not a room full of drag queens, and it was not a room full of drug users, and, you know, whatever. It was just a nice group of people trying to better their lives. And that impulse was really important. But the group failed to stay together because the next restaurant they could find to meet in was in front of open windows. Half the people wouldn't even come into the place because of fear of exposure. Not that it had been advertised anywhere where the police are going to come and say, "Hey, we're taking down your license numbers and taking your pictures and telling your mother you've been associating at an immoral place." But just the fear of being seen there, somebody connecting you to the gay community, somehow was enough to scare people away. So they couldn't keep the group together at that time. But later, after Stonewall, there was a politicization, not just a self-help impulse, but the politicization of that impulse. It said, you know what, we got to get together and just say no. We got to resist this together. And we saw a real flowering of particularly the groups of the left, the groups that were bold enough to say, you know, America isn't right all the time. This is fucking wrong. We're not going to put up with it. We've got to be militant. We've got to fight against it. Just like the blacks fought against it, just like women are fighting against it, just like any oppressed minority needs to fight against it. And a lot of us who were brought up as, you know, middle class kids and so forth didn't necessarily find that leftist point of view appealing, except for its the truth that rang through it, that we got to do something. We can't just sit and take it anymore. And I'm really getting mad as hell about it. And we had to take some action to help ourselves. And so that's what happened. It started happening everywhere.
Looking back at it, do you think that the actions that the group took back in the late 60s, then it has paid off for the gay and lesbian population?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's our ignition point. It's our memorial. It's our symbol of everything. We probably say more about Stonewall that didn't happen there than that actually did happen there. We have, you know, can build a mythology around those sites, but it is still a very important event. What's more important, though, is what happened with people who got together after, in the aftermath, to say, let's organize. Let's go march up the streets and go to Central Park. And they walked up from Greenwich Village to Central Park, not knowing if they were just making themselves targets to be assassinated by police and or homophobic community members, or if they were going to be able to survive all the way up to the park. And they, when they got to the park, they were able to celebrate. And thus is born the parade, march, pride event that we modeled around the country, and you still see happening everywhere.
Well, Roger, I tell you, when we get back from our break, I want to get into this this part of it, and address the idea, the question with you, as far as Stonewall and Pride Parade. Is this really, is Pride Parade really a movement, or was it a movement, an idea on the back of something that was so horrifying in American history? And there are a lot of people that say, with what happened at Stonewall, that was a very horrific time in American history, but I can tell you for sure that it was for the gay and the lesbian population. But being standing in Pride and celebrating a Pride festival, a Pride parade, with the notion in the back of your mind, constantly thinking, Stonewall, what happened back then? Folks, this is going to be an incredible look at this with our guest, Roger Winters, folks, right after this. Don't go away. Weekend here in Seattle. For those that want to know, the Seattle Pride Parade is this Sunday here in Seattle. And hey, we were talking, and we're still in conversation with our guest, Roger Winters. And the question came up, the comment, the concern, maybe. What do you think? That perhaps the anniversary of Stonewall. And when people think about Stonewall, or if they do, and here they are in a celebration march saying, you know, this is me. I'm gay, I'm lesbian, I'm bisexual, I'm transgender. This celebration is for me. And you take it as a personal note. Roger, do people take the Pride festivals around the world as a personal note, saying, look, this is for me. I am proud of who that I am. I'm proud of my community. And I'm proud of the voice that we have. Looking back at Stonewall, mind you.
Every time we have a parade, a march, a gathering like this, a rally, there are people who come out there for the first time.
Yes.
They've seen it happen before. They've seen it on the news. They kind of wanted to be there, but they were afraid. They were afraid Aunt Minnie will see them or somebody, and that things will be tough for them because of this exposure. But on the other hand, their need to belong, to express themselves, to say, this is me too, really comes through. And people are delighted to be there. If you look at the faces on people in during the Pride Parade as people go by and as people are applauded and people celebrate one another and they come together in their groups or their to march, to writhe, to dance, to protest, to hold up signs, to push candidates, to push condoms, to do all kinds of things. People just love it. Always the biggest hand goes to parents and friends of lesbians and gays, but why not? Of course it should. But
speaking of the Pride Parade, Roger, and you know it. To me, it is a nuisance. This is for this reason, and it's a bad. This is a really poor example, but here's the deal. A lot of people still, as of last year, there was a poll taken right after Pride festivities in various cities around the United States, and the poll suggested that a buttload, a lot of people, right? They look at the Pride Parade and that is their only identity or their only identifying marks in their life when it comes to gays and lesbians are as a direct result of the Pride Parade. So if you're going to have the dykes on bikes, right? I mean, that's always the start of every Pride Parade, right? If you're going to have those ladies, or if you're going to have, men dressed up like clowns, like Bozo, whatever. But rather than people saying that's part of the spirit of it, that's part of the fun of it, they say, oh no, that's why I don't want my kids to see this. Mm-hmm. And what would you say, Roger?
I understand their feelings, and I've had those feelings myself at times in the past, and I realized too that I should get over it, because this is a thing about diversity. This is about people who are different and being themselves, not conforming to some stereotype that makes me happy or some range of dress or behavior or attitude that makes me feel comfortable, but rather they are pushing the envelope to say to themselves in the world, I'm here, I'm queer, get used to it, I'm happy, I'm having fun, this is me, I'm going to keep doing this, and I don't care what you think about it, you should be doing this too. And if your image of yourself is different, then turn the image on, dress the occasion, or form the group, bring the signs, bring the costumes, whatever it is, and celebrate yourself. And celebrate me, and we'll celebrate one another, and it's going to be a joyous event. And that's really what's come of it, especially in the kind of gigantic events we have today. In 1980, a man named Lamar Faulkner and I took it on ourselves. We were active in the Dorian Group, which people thought was a rather conservative organization, but we took it on ourselves to organize the first parade on Broadway that ended in Volunteer Park. And we got a lot of criticism for it because we didn't open the doors to get all kinds of points of view about it. We just felt we're going to get the permits, we're going to make it a fait accompli and make it happen. And I got to give a speech at Volunteer Park. I was very active in the Dorian Group and in CMEC and some other things that year. And I challenged people to stand up for the liberation of everyone and to be ready for the challenges of the 80s. Well, we had 4,000 people there. We thought that was pretty darn good. And later I saw in Los Angeles 90,000 people in like 82. And I was dumbfounded at that. And now I see twice that and maybe three times that even in my own Seattle downtown. And just a huge turnout of people who are doing just that, celebrating the diversity of the community and doing it with their friends or doing it alone or experimenting and finding their way to come out and connect. Every one of us goes through this evolution. You know, we're born in this society, heterosexist society, that assumes we're all going to grow up to be married to people of the opposite sex and have children, and we'll have a similar religious, political beliefs that our parents do and that are acceptable on television
and G-rated and whatever. And we're influenced by every possible means of persuasion society has from before our birth throughout our lives to be heterosexuals. We're trained relentlessly for that role. And we're trained relentlessly to get married and to have a wedding. We're not trained relentlessly to have good relationships and to be good partners and parents, but that's a little more complicated. But we are at least trained to embrace that. And it's amazing how many of us resist it and do not take that on. We don't stick with the training. I've never been heterosexual at all. And it's been 69 years now I've been on this planet, and I'm quite happy with that. But I've been fortunate too that I haven't been in positions of extreme danger because of my differentness. But I've had supportiveness in my family that was both surprising but welcome when it came out. But it took a while to get there. So we all go through this evolution of wondering, well, if I'm different, if I'm gay, where do I fit in? What happens? Where do I connect with the community? I connected with community through cruising the parks, or cruising, going to gay bars in Indianapolis, or going to places in Boston as I was getting into graduate school and trying to decide, where do I connect? Where do I go safely to meet people? And it took a while before I started to meet real people that I could say, these will become my friends. These were not just encounters of people who are hiding in the closet, but still reaching out for experiences because they want to just have those experiences, because we want to connect, touch, make love with people, whatever. And we crave that, but we don't know where to go and what to do. I didn't know if I was supposed to turn into a drag queen in order to be gay during the time I was in high school and in college. I learned later that, it wasn't required, but it was an option. It was available. But I could also be a motorcycle rider if I wanted to be. Or I could be a conservative business person who dressed in Brooks Brothers clothes and never, ever strayed from a fairly conservative self-image. And I could do all of those things and still be perfectly, beautifully gay if I wanted to be. And I needed to say, I'm proud of myself, I'm happy with myself, and I'm happy that other people are finding their ways of expressing themselves too within this community. I can sing We Are Family with people who I wouldn't associate with socially very often because I just don't have that much in common with them, and they don't have that much in common with me. But we feel family-like when we party together, when we dance together, when we celebrate together, because we know we're all living this this dream of really finally being ourselves. And it's a big weight that comes off of us when that happens.
Roger, I'll tell you what, for me as an outsider looking in, I'm very impressed with you because you were around prior to Stonewall. You saw what was going on. You've been able to remember that, reflect back on that later in life, and now here we are in 2014, and now we have some of the most open and some of the most elaborate pride parades and festivities anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Every
young gay man, for example, is probably thinking, what gay character on television am I supposed to emulate?
Right.
Am I supposed to have a lisp? Am I supposed to be butch? Am I supposed to be, whatever? What am I supposed to be? What am I supposed to do? Who do I please? And it takes a while before they learn to please themselves and to find themselves and be who they are, not to be anyone but who they are. And that there are opportunities to be who they are, even when it's quite spectacular who they are and how flamboyant and delightfully different they choose to be. And for me, it was like I exulted in and loved the activism because I saw we were making changes in real lives and in history and attitudes. And I felt we are going to win because we're on the right path. There's nothing wrong with this pursuit of freedom, of equality, because we're not taking anything from anybody else. We're taking it for ourselves, what they already enjoy. And we're making sure that we defend their freedoms as well. This is something that belongs to everyone. When we win, everyone wins. When the other side, the oppressive side, wins, everyone loses. And that's been what sustained me throughout. It's just the excitement that we were on a winning side, and we have, in fact, really brought it home.
Well, who in your opinion, Roger, are the oppressors to the LGBTI community?
There are political leaders of organizations. Many of them are religious organizations. Many of them are social organizations who have felt it's important to constrain the impulse of those of us who want to be different in America, because it offends their God, or offends their morality, or offends their sense of what is right and wrong. People say, I can't conceive of same-sex marriage. Can't be the same as my marriage. Well, of course it can't be the same, but no one's marriage should be the same as anyone else's marriage, because it's a unique connection of two people who are saying we're powerfully enough connected that we want to proclaim that and institutionalize it legally and enter into and enjoy one of the most privileged legal relationships you can have in American society. There are other people who say marriage isn't for me. I worked in the marriage movement here for a decade and a half or so, and I'm not married. I'm not likely to be married. I'm happy being single now, but you never know. But still, it's not the fulfilling thing. It's one thing that matters a lot for people who are connected like that, but it's not the only thing. I have the right to marry, and that's important to me. That makes me a real adult in this society, because I can pick my next of kin.
I mean, in my way of thinking, Roger, I would look at those that are the oppressors, both political and religious, because these politicians who often use the Bible, the Scripture, the holy Word of God, for what it's worth, they use this and they say, look, this is my bully pulpit, but I'm only going to be a seasonal Christian, and that is when it is convenient for me to lash out and hate somebody else because they're Jewish, because they're Catholic, because they're gay. And they do this, Roger, with a smirk on their face, and, you know, and then they say, oh, vote for me. And these idiots get in office. So, in my opinion, those are the oppressors, the real, true oppressors that always have been. I mean, look back at Stonewall and what had happened. And according to the reports, the first riot actually in the United States has started at the hand of one lesbian. In defiance, in protest against what happened at Stonewall. So looking at Stonewall in the rearview mirror, sort of a black and white photo, and then looking at the events this weekend in Seattle and around the country, here in the States, of the color, the beauty, the togetherness, the familyness, the, you know, all this. But again, going back to the statistic that I was talking about, even as of late last year, they were saying, you know, a lot of Americans will only identify with gay and lesbians based on what they see at Pride, and that is not a very good way to look at the gay and lesbian population. So, Roger, what are these straight, stereotypical men and women? What are they missing if they only see gay and lesbians during Pride Parade and address that only.
Well, one of the criticisms been consistent is that the press can't resist showing the most flamboyant, colorful, outrageous people present and ignoring the most plain, normal, ordinary people who are also there. And people have been frustrated with that tendency in the media. It seems inevitable, especially since news has become, for most news agencies, a matter of entertainment, not of information. And so, in order to entertain, they show, you know, they compete to show the most flashy, most ridiculous or funny or whatever. And that's a shame. But if people attend the program, I think they see the love and the respect, the celebration, the laughter, the very uplifting sentiments, the persistent militance of some of the people who want to show, they're there to march, they're there to push the issue, to continue to defy society and say, revolution is needed here, and I'm part of it, and we're going to continue to change society, and, you know, be warned, this is happening. But all of us find, you know, how many people do any of us know in the world? How many friends on Facebook can you have and still have a life?
Right.
Yeah. And people that you know personally are limited, are finite. The rest of the human beings on the planet are strangers to us. And we, frankly, when we encounter them on the streets, we don't know if they're going to kill us or kiss us or ignore us. Mostly they'll ignore us. We stand aside for each other, and we learn to accommodate people in our society, and we dread the breakdown of order when suddenly somebody pulls a gun and starts shooting at random people, or when a group of militants takes over city after city in a certain country because they're pushing their religious variations on somebody else and carrying out battles and over issues that have been raging for thousands of years in their communities. Well, those are the kinds of breakdowns we fear, but for the most part, we accommodate each other and we get together with our friends and family members when we can, the people we join the clubs with, the people we socialize with, that we work together with in causes or charities or churches or sports, you know, sporting events, or raising kids together, or going to school with, and, you know, so forth. And we want to enjoy their company. But we all have those personal experiences. They're very similar for all of us, but they're still unique and different for you and for me, as to who we know, who we really click with, who we like, who likes us. And growing up, we had our playmates, and our playmates taught us our prejudices. Our playmates taught us the fears that were passed on from generation to generation. If the parents didn't correct those fears, we were all told about the people of color, the people with the funny labels, the Jews and their habits, and the blacks and their habits, and the Italians, and, you know, and so forth and so on. That was my experience, that I learned more prejudice from other kids than from anything ever said in my home. But it took a while to get over that. But that's a mechanism that for oppression passes, I think, a lot of times. Because when you're a kid and you're saying, you know, I'm different from this, I kind of like that queer notion that I'm hearing talked about in fear and loathing, but it's kind of appealing to me because there's something there that is part of me. And I was hungry for information. I looked in the dictionary and I found, when I found the word homosexual, it wasn't very helpful. But when I found a psychology book in the library, I was able to read about it, a few paragraphs. And they said something about homosexuality could be a phase that a boy or a girl would go through. And I thought, oh, goodness, thank goodness, it's a phase. I just have to wait for the phase to lift.
Yes.
And then everything will be normal. So I could just relax, enjoy what I was doing, and I'm still waiting for the phase to lift.
Well, you know what? Roger, there are a lot of people who still live more or less with their head in the sand, And they're like, you know, look, all I have to do is ignore it, and these people will go away. This idea, this fad, will go away. So the deeper that I can bury my head, the sooner this will actually happen. It hasn't happened yet.
Well, something important happened in our lives in the 80s and the 90s that we have to acknowledge. And that is that people around us and our friends and associates and people we loved started to die. And those deaths and those illnesses forced people out of their closets in order to call for help, to ask for help from families and friends, from doctors, from researchers, from the government, from everywhere to get relief from this awful, awful plague that we all experienced and went through. And it is, in a sense, that Holocaust, that horrible time, that also brought with it the silver lining of awareness. Suddenly, people in all walks of life knew there was someone in their family, connected to their family, connected to their church, connected to their community, connected to them, who was suffering from this disease and who was gay. And they had to come to terms with that. And it was hard to hate people who were simply ill and dying and put in a terrible situation. People who had compassion opened their hearts to us and became allies and supporters. People who wanted to hate continued to hate, perhaps hated even further, because they could say, like Pat Buchanan said, you know, God is punishing the gays because of their, you know, they were wrong. And so he's giving them this illness and so forth. He said, no, no, the illness is Pat Buchananism. So that really changed the picture of our society, and it made us very serious, a lot of us. But we have to continue in this, because even in the most adverse conditions, we need to stand up for our dignity, to insist on our rights, to insist on our desert to have help and support, just like people in other walks of life who have hurricanes and earthquakes and other diseases that ravage their communities, and they deserve help and they deserve support, because we believe people who are living on this planet deserve to be continuing to breathe and be wet by the rain and enjoy the planet on which they live. Because why? Because they're here. And that's a great philosophy to embrace, I think.
It is, Roger. I mean, this is, surely it is our season. It is our time. And of any society, of any group of people, to be able to enjoy the things in life that we have today, it is our generations, our joint generations, that are enjoying some of those things. Now, surely we're not in the States, we're not seeing rights extended maybe as fast as perhaps some would prefer, but at least it is doing something. And now we have the federal government saying, yes, what's the big deal? The end of DOMA, that was a good thing, the Defense of Marriage Act. And now here we have, we're on the heels, literally, of the Gay Pride Parade in Seattle. You know, and we're like, wow, you know, looking back at Stonewall, that was for the now generation, that's like something that happened like 100 years ago. You see what I mean?
The Employment Non-Discrimination Act, it says you can't fire people from their jobs in America just because of their sexual orientation. We have it in localities, we have it in states like Washington, we have such laws, but we don't have that national, we don't have that affirmation that you are wrong to punish someone based on their sexual orientation or your perception of their sexual orientation by depriving them of housing, depriving them of a job, depriving them of fair treatment in a job, and depriving them of goods and services that are freely available to other people. Those are important messages, and they require legislation, and they require organizing and efforts that are ongoing and are going to continue to need our contributions, our participation, our writing letters to the editor, our writing to Congress and our representatives, our electing with better representatives, our, you know, stepping up and working for those causes. And this is years and years yet to come. We have by far not fulfilled the entire work of the gay agenda.
Well, Roger, I'll tell you what, when we come back from our break, let's get into this a little bit more because, you know, some people still say, hey, the gays have an agenda. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if the gay population has an agenda, in your opinion, what is it? Hey, I can only tell you what my opinion is. Roger can tell you what his opinion is. But what do you think? Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show. We'll be back live from Seattle here in just a minute or three. Stay tuned, folks, for more. With our special guest Roger Winters. He is a good friend, a dear friend, a personal friend that I've had for several years. And so, Roger, actually, we have known each other for quite a few years. You know, and I would not take not one of those years back either. It's been a great pleasure knowing you.
Well, I've been around a few years, and I've been involved in a lot of things that have happened here in Seattle and King County and Washington State. My activism goes back to the 70s when I first came here. I was assistant professor of political science at Central for a few years. I used to write letters to the editor about homosexuality and Anita Bryant and things like that, and kind of acting like, well, the reason I can talk about this is because I'm an ACLU activist and I'm a professor of political science, and so I can speak with some authority. But I couldn't say that I was queer. I was gay. This is me you're talking about. I was still afraid enough that I had to stay in the closet. But in time, I left that behind, and I came to Seattle, and I worked for a gay organization, and I worked in the gay community on many, many projects over time. Things about elections, things about police relations, things about charitable enterprises, things about marriage, equality. And I was far enough away from my family, far enough away from the people that I feared personally, that I could act without fully breaking down my closet, without bothering them too much about my issues, and still do something concrete to advance the cause. And I was really privileged and happy to do that here. We made the world safer for diversity here. Over those years, and it was fun, and it was fulfilling and exciting to see it happen. Many, many times I have stood in the same room as people like Ed Murray and George Bacon and others, you know, who've lived through the cause of beating back an initiative, beating back a referendum effort, winning something achievable for employees, winning, you know, domestic partner benefits, winning finally marriage. It took us a while to get there. we didn't have the court support that we wanted initially. But we all chipped in and participated in it and worked hard, and it happened. And we got the people of our state to go along with us and vote our way. That was wonderful. Because it used to be the case, if you had HOMO on the ballot, you lost. Mm-hmm. No matter where you were, you lost by 60-80% in the voting. And we turned that around in Seattle in 1978. And we turned it around in Washington State in with referendum 71 and referendum 74. We still don't have everyone on our side, but the majorities now reported recently are 50-59% of the people supporting marriage equality.
Do you think that maybe that the attitude of the typical American when it comes to gays and lesbians has changed since the late 1960s?
Yes. The reason for that is, one, their awareness of us has changed. They could successfully largely ignore us and not be bothered with our existence if they were careful enough, to close their ears, to be sure certain things weren't said around the children, to be sure that these topics are not covered. But as the news and technology bringing news to our eyes and ears, got more and more involved in the rural areas and the heartland of the country, then people were on alert that there are men who dress as women, there are men who are with motorcycles, there are women with motorcycles, there are politicians, there are lobbyists, there are articulate people, there are lawyers, there are lots of people who say they're gay. And there are characters in my television shows, and there are members of my family who are standing up and saying, deal with this. And even in families that are rejecting these people, they're dealing with it. They're becoming more aware, more, if not accepting, more rejecting. They're still embracing the issue as real, more and more and more. And it's now impossible, I think, it's almost impossible to be an American and not know what gay, lesbian means in our society. That they are terms that some people treat with dignity and respect, and others treat with derision and laughter and hatred.
What do you think about President Barack Obama? His statements on gays and lesbians, his support for gays and lesbians, is a political pull or a political ploy on his part or his party? Or do you think that it's really the right thing to do from the office of the president?
It had to be guarded in terms of how he expressed his support. I mean, I feel that he was supportive all along. I felt the support for us from other leaders over time, Robert Kennedy, John Kennedy even, and McGovern and others. But knew and could tell that it was not possible for them to embrace our issues boldly and squarely in the public eye as politicians. And they hedged, and they had to. When we interviewed candidates for CMEC in those early years of 77 onward, we were asking them hard questions about, what do you read about? What have you read about gay people? Who do you know about? What do you know about gay people from their real experience? These were tough questions for politicians to embrace, including our supporters, because we were challenging them to say, put up or shut up. Are you really for us, or are you going to just hide when the bill comes due? And we need your vote. Are you going to just be absent because you don't want to vote against us, but you don't want to vote for us? If that's the case, we want to know that, and we want to tell our voting gay community where you stand, that's all. And we did that more and more, and we gained the respect of those politicians, and many of them started turning around and saying, this is a moral principle I embrace, is that these people deserve non-discrimination. These people deserve funding of their health issues, they deserve whatever the issue of the day was. And that's happened more and more. And I was glad to see the tipping point around same-sex marriage. I remember, for me, I thought it happened. I saw it tipping most when Governor Gregoire spoke so eloquently for same-sex marriage and had overcome her Catholic upbringing, her traditional views, and had replaced it due to her experience with real people. And she made that clear and expressed it very well. It wasn't long after that we heard from Joe Biden, and then we heard from the president, and then we hear from Hillary, and we hear from other people, that they're relenting. And finally today, Bill Clinton, relenting on the positions they took. We were so disappointed when Bill Clinton signed the DOMA in the dark of night in the White House one night, without fanfare, without celebration, but certainly without hesitation, too. And we thought that was an awful betrayal. But
speaking of that, Roger, I remember back on in the TV studio several years ago, I made the comment about Bill Clinton, and I said, "Look, you know, this is what's going to happen: is that DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, it's going to turn and bite him square in the butt." And you know what? It did. And I can sit back and now I can say, you know what, I'm glad that I said that, because I still stand on that today. It bit him. So what was in it for him? Well, now I ask, what's in it for President Barack Obama?
Well, he's not running for re-election again.
No. True.
It has to do with his principles, I think, and he's taking a principled stand. He's taking a supportive and friendly stand. I think he's finally been able to embrace a position he's always wanted to embrace, and finally has the political freedom to do so, and to do it in a classy and eloquent way that is going to help influence other people to emulate that action. So often we've seen politicians in the past who had to stay lukewarm, who had to keep us at arm's length, who had to stay in their closet as a supporter of our rights and our issues. I think that's going to happen less and less as time goes on. There's nothing wrong with embracing our cause. As I said, everyone wins when we say people should be free to marry whom they choose, who are otherwise qualified under the laws to be married with them. They are entitled to associate freely with others, to speak freely about what they want to, how they want to express themselves, to form religious groups and worship together as they see fit. And we have to respect that in everyone else. Similar freedom for everyone else is what we must give in order to enjoy these freedoms ourselves.
Well, do you think that, look back at it like this, as far as Stonewall, let's go back there and look at that black and white picture again. Do you think that looking at Stonewall back then, that it would have been a far better idea for same-sex marriage, for that to be legal back then, that if it's a marriage, people would be like, what's that? Versus the firestorm that those two issues have become in the United States.
Robert, I don't know, because back then, I don't know how many couples were ready to marry. Our institutions, our bars, our baths, our clubs, whatever, were not the breeding ground for marital couples and picket fences and baby carriages.
Right.
They were the breeding grounds of competition for dates, for prettiest boy, prettiest girl, whatever it was, that was very divisive in its way. We were not, I say, why do you take your lover to the bars? Because people are just going to try to take him away from you. And instead, it's people who found their niche in their social group, their activity with others who recognized and respected couples as committed and so forth, that did that. When we started the marriage movement here in 1995, it took us a few years before we could find couples who would talk to the press. And every time we made contact with another marriage movement organization, it was, do you have any couples? do you have any couples that we could borrow and use and get a statement from them in front of the press about how they live together and they have a house and they have a mortgage and they are normal and they're ordinary like everybody else? It was until we could get those stories told and those wonderful plaintiffs that came forward in places like Hawaii and Massachusetts and other places who told their stories and who spoke their values and lived their values, that we started to win, because they were real people, not just theories.
Well, you know what, Roger, the July 4th, next week, right? Oh my God, it is. Will be, Steve, my partner and I, our 20th year anniversary on the 4th. And, you know, people, you know, they sit back, they scratch their head, and they say, wow, that's either a lot of devotion or that's a lot of something kind of going on. You know, and to me, it is mind-boggling to know that 20 years with Steve, my own partner, you know, hey, it hasn't been a walk in the park, but surely we have had our obstacles. And in our own relationship, we, you know, back when you couldn't get married, now you can get married. You can actually get divorced now if you wanted to. I mean, it's crazy. But, you know, how time has so passed the last 20 years, and the battle for equality has continued to rage onward with great strides. Roger, I'm very amazed.
I think everybody will come to, you know, go through a series of steps of opening to more and more diversity in their community, of recognizing and embracing it, of having less and less objection about the parades, about what's there, because they see that if I can't let others who are quite different from me be featured on the streets and in these events the same way I want to be featured and understood by my peer group and family group and socioeconomic peers or whatever, if I can't let them be free, I can't really be free myself. And it's too bad the press is doing, you know, it's going to cover the most outrageous. But on the other hand, I could join, and people have joined, you know, groups where you had men in suits and briefcases doing military-style marching on the streets, you know, and dancing together to express that they could be stockbrokers who are gay, and they could be conservatives who are gay, and they could be just fine like everyone else. That not everyone is got fairy wings, or not everyone has muscles and motorcycles, and not everyone has other hallmarks of some stereotype that, and we stop finding that offensive and find it instead exhilarating, because it is a celebration of diversity. That's the overwhelming theme, I think, for us that matters most, is we want the world safe for diversity, for people to be different. The differences that people express are the future of our society. They are the melting pot where ideas and traditions and new ideas take place, and this and our society, our species will need to resort to those ideas in the future as time goes on. Every generally accepted idea was originally a minority viewpoint. It was originally an unwelcome, perhaps, idea that someone broached and got laughed at or got rejected or whatever. But it became valuable to us all, because over time it proved to be true. And that's where we get our genetic versatility, our ability to evolve, our ability to deal with changing circumstances, our ability to rise above the past, to growth away from mistakes, towards new successes, to find new models and ways of dealing with our problems and of meeting our opportunities.
Well, I was saying this to Roger, that people, and I never have understood this, but some people have the idea that for them to be able to identify and help to curtail maybe their own anger, they lash out at somebody else in that anger. And rather than having, you know, an attitude and a mindset that they are so willing to accept change and accept diversity for what it is, a lot of people sit back and say, I'm not going to do this because it's the gays. What is so evil about gay people?
I don't know. Nothing more evil than about any people. The things that have, that stood out for me as important things have been the bold steps people have taken to parody ourselves, to make fun of ourselves, to laugh about things. Groups like the Taxi Tourist Clubs of America, bless their hearts, here in Seattle, have shown us the way with things that go bump in the night, the Halloween parties, the prom you never went to, Lavender Valley High School, and Sister Mary Discipline the Principal, and poodle skirts, and dancing and promming together, just like we were in high school again. And here we are in our 50s or 40s or 30s or 60s and having a ball together and raising money for charity together with the Queen City Cruises and what have you. They have made fun of ourselves and have put out these stereotypes, the over-sexualized view of things, the rigid, restricted principal of the school, whatever. These are parodies, and they're fun, and people are laughing and having a good time and learning not to fear stuff that they can laugh at, and then they can take the power away from it by doing that.
Well, let me go back into history a little bit. During the Stonewall period, Roger. Because today, a lot of younger people, bless their heart, they have a lot of people in media that they can look at and say, hey, they are my hero. If they are a radio show host, if they are a television personality, a newspaper editor. But, you know, they have somebody that is in the limelight that they can look up to for a lot of reasons. But back in the day of Stonewall, who did people have to look up to that were gay or lesbian?
I just thought of a man that I met once in Provincetown, Massachusetts, Cape Cod, 1968, I think, or 67. And his name was Charles Pierce. And Charles Pierce was a female impersonator. He had a wonderful show, and he did Betty Davis, and he did other actresses, and he was hilarious and funny and clever, and he was so talented and skillful in doing it. He had us roaring and laughing and splitting our seams, and it was, and we talked to him afterwards, and he was just a fun, well-adjusted man. He was happy expressing himself in this way, and it was outrageous. It was cross-dressing in spades. It was just, terrifically bold of him to do this publicly. Sure, he might not succeed in Omaha or Peoria trying to push his show, but he could find the places where people loved it. And it wasn't just gay people who loved it. It was the folks who would turn out in New York City or in, other cultural centers to see an artist of this quality who could do such a wonderful job of entertaining people, of parodying the great granddams of the cinema and theater and what have you, and do it so well. I had a whole lot of fun going to that show that time, and meeting the man himself was really a thrill.
So, as far as the nationwide. I mean, you look at CNN, you think of Anderson Cooper, the gay journalist. But back then, who was there that was Well, syndicated perhaps, or maybe not so much, that you even looked up to.
Quentin Crisp.
He would be in.
He's wonderful. The Naked Civil Servant. And, you know, he into his 90s, was performing here in America. And he said some things that got him in trouble with our community as well as others and so forth. But he was a very clever man. He went through a lot. The Naked Civil Servant was shown on public television. John Hurt played the role. He was a great guy, a great man, and probably one of our heroes. Yes, but there are also people like the founder of the Metropolitan Community Church, people who organized organizations in various places that have, you know, the Gay Men's Health Crisis, ACT UP, Larry Kramer's work, the Normal Heart, which is out on cable now on HBO and such, playing a very poignant story about the era of AIDS and so forth. These are heroic people. Martina Navratilova, lots of Gene O'Leary, Bob Eichberg, lots of people who made their mark in the world, helping us to come out, helping us to grow up, helping us to be real people and to be proud of ourselves and to be energized by the challenges that around us. And it was a pleasure to have met some of those folks and to have been under their influence. And it helped me to be more effective at my hobby of pushing gay rights and fighting for our cause here, there, and everywhere that I could.
Well, do you suppose maybe that there are just as many challenges today facing the LGBT community than there were back in the 60s?
Probably. And there are new challenges as well. Back in the days of the Dorian Group, the activity groups that they had associated with them were a few. Hiking group, which I think is still going on. Group that would get together to play games, board games or something, and so forth. And we had a social calendar that we could put in our newsletter, and people found some activities. They could get together with other gay, lesbian people and do stuff together. And that was thrilling. Then came along groups like the Chorus, and groups like the automobile clubs, and groups like the church and the churches and the religious groups, Dignity and so on and so forth. And these groups started a process of creating new organizations, new things, new activities, new meeting places, new... If you look at the Seattle Gay News today, you will find hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of things you could go to and be part of in any given week now, where we might have had a handful that you could go to in the course of a month and break out of the bars and the baths and the, you know, the dances as your only opportunities to meet people. And you could meet people that were engaged in other activities that you like to do, that were stamp collectors like you, or that were into revolutionary politics, or into making log cabin republicanism more prevalent, or whatever it was. You could find your affinity groups. And once you found your affinity groups, you could also find people who you would eventually perhaps marry, because you already had something in common with them. You had an organization that didn't tear you apart, but rather brought you together and helped you build something, a relationship together because of it. People who could become broadcasters, people who could become, you know, get the message out, whatever it may be, that said, we're here, we're creating good history, we're proud of ourselves, we're going to do real good stuff here. This is not trivial, this isn't fun and games, this is serious business. And sometimes it's fun, serious business, but we're going to do it. People like you are bold enough to have both sides together in the debate. And to bring some really rather nasty folks to the table to hear their points of view on things like referendum 71.
Well, Roger, you know, back in the that was a historic moment. It definitely was. And looking back at it now, it actually holds more historical significance than it ever did before. Folks that missed that, it was a referendum 71 across the date that we did. Roger was one of the panelists on the that day in the studio. But Roger, you're right. We had both sides. We had those that were for it, those that were against it. But you know, it had to work. I had to find a common ground at least at the end to make it work. And do you remember what I had asked at the very end of that debate?
Exactly.
I can tell you straight up what it was, because everybody was mad, everybody was very aggravated on both sides, they really were. They were, I mean, folks, it was sort of like, you know, I'm going to pull this guy's hair because I don't like him. But I'd ask, the last question was, do you like chicken?
Yes.
Folks, I did. I asked them because, you know, if you want to get people together and get people in unity and people to agree on something of nothing else, ask them if they like chicken. And you'll find out, you know, who your foes are, right? But we found out.
I had the privilege of participating in something that was not publicized, but it was really important. And that was, I was president of the Legal Marriage Alliance of Washington. And I got a phone call one day at my home from Jeff Kemp. Jeff Kemp was a leader of the Family Values Group or whatever, and he said he would like to have a meeting of some people on his side of the fence and some people on my side of the fence. And could I bring some people together to come to his office and talk? And I took him up on it. And I got two members of my board to go with me. And we met on a series of Fridays, three of us on our side, three on his side, and we talked as real people together about why do you care about this issue? What brings you the energy you have for it? What motivates you? You know, and so forth. What do you say in response to these other people when they express their sincere beliefs? And it built a mutuality of respect and appreciation, even in our differences. And I really was pleased to see Jeff Kemp taking the initiative to make it happen. And I was glad to make it happen from our side, because I felt that it was building a bridge of people who were sincerely concerned about stuff, and that we could start to break down some of the barriers built because of anger and hatred and suspicion and fear on both sides over time. And I'm glad to say that Jeff relented. He doesn't show up at all the anti-gay statement appearances anymore. And he is still working, so far as I know, on family issues and trying to bring the Christian families he knows about together so they have happier, better relationships, or do better jobs with their children, and so forth. Those are things that you just have to applaud him for doing that. But he's not so much preaching for everybody's got to have a mommy and a daddy. He's, I think, come to understand there's more in heaven and earth than just those stereotypes.
Well, Roger, you know, I've got to say that it has not been that long ago, but we had on two shows, we had two people from Westboro Baptist Church. Back before Fred Phelps, before he died, but we also had one of Fred Phelps's grandsons on the show. Now, you want to talk about something that was mind-blowing, because his grandson does not share anywhere near the theological mayhem of his grandfather. But to see the different generational message, because Fred's generation, he actually was a civil rights warrior, and suddenly he decided to be a stick in the mud, more or less, when it came to the LGBTI community. But his grandson, one of his grandsons, is nowhere near that. So I mean, I I take great pride, Roger, with getting people to come on the show. I may not agree with them. I might agree with them, but at least for historical purposes and to get a message out, a central message that, you know what, we can still all get along.
Right. You know, we've had an impetus in our community to be more professional, to be more poll aware, to be more savvy in our strategies and so forth. That's led us sometimes to say, oh, your group shouldn't do that. You shouldn't have this kind of discussion, or shouldn't open the door to this possibility. It'll backfire on us. Well, there's maybe some wisdom in that. People take it to heart. But on the other hand, I think we've always had, aside from, in addition to the organizations and the organized efforts, well-funded efforts in our community to achieve our goals in health and culture and politics and legislation, that we've had this spontaneity and diversity of approach that people take on their own. And we have to say, go for it. Do what you think is best, because you'll find out if it works or not.
Well, you know what? Even in this media, I've said a lot of times, you know, it's either do or die. It's either that people are going to support it, people are going to support the shows, people are going to watch the shows, people are going to share the information as we get it, even, and share this, or we're going to die on the vine. But I would rather die on the vine by trying to do something than do nothing and be just a sourpuss from hell. You know what I mean?
Right. And you can never be the person that everyone tunes in to listen to. That's going to be very traumatic. But you can't, it's not realistic to think that, you know, have such grandiose ideas. But you'll have a following. You'll have people who listen to your message, like your style, like your guests, like your subject matter. And that's just going to appeal to the people it appeals to. There was a TED Talk recently, a musician was on it, and she said she went to a record company with her group, and they sold 25,000 albums, and she thought that was wonderful. The record company said it was a failure, because it was only 25,000, and she said, but 25,000 people liked the music, and they got to enjoy it, and that was fulfillment enough. And she got to the point, she's one of these now leading to say, music should be freely given away, and then the artist should ask for support from the people who like what they do, and be supported by people. And that was a really good message, I think.
You know, somebody had asked me, Roger, who my mentor was, and I actually have two of them. One of them, Larry King, the talk show host Larry King. I've always adored him. And secondly, well, off the beaten path, Mr. Rogers. I loved him. Fred Rogers. Because he made everybody feel important. He really did. And I want to make all of our guests, I want to make everybody that watches the shows or listen to the podcast feel just the same. Everybody has something to say, and everybody needs a way to say it in the most effective way. Hey, Roger, let's take our last break for this show. So hang on, if you will. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. For those that have not been there, visit us there and see what we're about. We have podcasts. We have different things up there that you can see. And, of course, the newsletter is up there as well. So, folks, we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this. Don't go away. It's good to have everybody joining us. And in Seattle, if you'd like to get a hold of us, you can call us at area 206-736-9688, and we'll be back. No, I'm not Rachel Maddow, but hey, I'm better looking. We'll be back. All right. right, ladies and gentlemen, hey, it is a joy to have everybody with us today, and my good dear friend Roger Winters. I have known Roger. Oh my gosh, Roger, when did we meet? It was 2002, 2003,
somewhere along those that time.
It's been quite a while ago, and you know what? We have seen history made in Seattle, in Washington State, and we were talking before the break about the Referendum 71 battle royale. It really was. But you know what, Roger? No, I'm not Rachel Maddow. Doggone it. But you know what? At least I had the opportunity to have both sides of that debate on the same platform, the same time, the same day. And nobody else did that. And I still remember that there was a major media in Seattle, including CNN, that wanted copies of the data file, but I could not get it sent to them fast enough.
You also broached the idea that hardly anyone wanted to talk about, but I thought it was a perfectly legitimate point, that when it came to marrying people, the clerks and government organizations that issued marriage licenses weren't doing their job. They weren't checking to make sure they had a man and a woman, in fact, there. They were not looking under the hood to find out and do the sex checking that was important. And you know, we had a couple in our constituency in the Legal Marriage Alliance, volunteers, who were wonderful people, two women. But they were originally a man and a woman when they were married, and legally married in Washington. And they were then, thanks to the sex change that one chose to undergo to become him herself more fully, they are a wonderful couple of women who were legally married before anyone else could be legally married in Washington, who were of the same gender. And that was great to notice.
You know, there was a couple of months ago we had Nicole Bray, and she is undergoing surgery, her final surgery to become a full-fledged woman from a man, including the facial reconstructive surgery on the bone structures and all of this. And I mean, her entire what am I trying to say? Everything about her is so changed from the way that it was, and she is a very pretty woman. And she used to be a man. The interesting thing about it, Roger, is that she does have complete support of her wife, because she is married, and support of her mother. That is unheard of. So I think that as far as the gay, lesbian, bi, and transgender population, going back from the days of Stonewall, no, I can't say that there are any more gay or lesbians that are out there, but surely I think that there are more that are upfront with who that they are, honest with who they are, honest with themselves and each other, their family, their friends, more so now than before. What would you have to say, though, about that, Roger?
I had to think back about pre-Stonewall, before Stonewall, to groups like the Madison Society. They picketed the White House once. They carried signs asking to be left alone, to be allowed to keep their jobs, to have some basic human dignity and legal equality. Please don't hurt us, that sort of thing. That was an important message. That was a very bold statement that they made to picket the White House and be in the news. Some of them still lost their federal jobs in time, and yet they were heroic leaders of something that came together in a somewhat different form, maybe more rich form over time, because the ideas they broached had time to percolate more and develop and be energized by the spirit of Stonewall in the groups that followed there. What happened before the Madison Society? What was there? There were clubs, organizations, there were affinity groups for us. We were all subject to harassment by police, by hostile people, all subject to blackmail, all subject to
all kinds of negative consequences if our closets were broken down. But we also were seeking each other's company and seeking society together with each one another, because that was who we were. That was part of our fulfillment and our happiness as human beings, was to be with people we could love and relate to. Back in the 30s in Germany, there was the Magnus Hirschfeld and his Society for Sexual Information and Research, and his group was working towards defining sexual liberation for women and for men. They had a homophile aspect to their work. What happened to them? Well, they were stopped. The Nazi government at one point decided to root out the homosexuals who had helped to build the Nazi Party, and to either kill them, round them up to send them to camps. And as regards to Mr. Hirschfeld's organization, they looted the office, they pulled the books out onto the street, and they burned them. And the film of that book burning is still part of the standard film you see about the Nazi era. What happened to the people before then? What happened to people like us in the 19th century, the 18th century, the 12th century, the 8th century? Are we part of the human species, naturally occurring part of the human's diversity? I think so, and I think we always have been. But I think we have to realize that there was, for whatever reason, a very strong, hostile reaction to our form of loving and our form of socializing and living, our differences from the prevailing habits and patterns of life then. There were no pride parades for people during the heyday of the Inquisition or whatever. There was very little support for resistance to, but there were people still who defied that kind of tyranny, who stood up for what they believed and stood up for who they were. And society's response to them was very primitive, very cruel, very violent, and very, well, bestial. But we've changed the world in the 20th and 21st centuries, and we need to keep that change alive. We need the folks who are just hearing about Stonewall for the first time and wondering, what is that? I talked to a friend in his 40s the other day, and he didn't know. I talked to people in their 20s, and they didn't know much about it. And I tried to fill them in a bit and just say, suggest, this is something important for us that you might keep your ears open to learn more about. Not because we want you to admire the things we did, but because we want you to know the kind of experience and the quality of life we had in the past and that others have had in the further past, and how important it is that we not let things go back there, that we not let society oppress people again to the point of taking away their ability to be themselves, to love as they choose to love, to live as they choose to live. This is a fulfillment of a philosophy of freedom, of human potential, and that is important. It's part of a broad sweep of history, and we want to stay on the right side of history. We want to keep history moving in the right direction, and I think that that's going to take our participation into the future. People who are now in their teens and their 20s need to be ready when they're in my age to say, I spent 30, 40 years in groups working on the issues of my time and keeping the walls of, you know, keeping the water at bay, keeping the dikes there to prevent the flood or whatever. And so should the next generation and the next and the next and the next. I mean, this needs to persist. this needs to continue. It needs to blossom. It needs to change. It needs to become whatever it needs to be in the future. And that means come out and out of the bushes, out of the bars, into the streets, find out what is needed, participate in it, give it your attention, give it your support, write a check, say thank you to people, whatever it takes. Be as much a volunteer as you can be. But don't neglect it, don't ignore it. It's the very thing that's given you the possibility of happiness and success that you have today.
Well, Roger, you know, there's a... It only appears to me that people ignore things. They don't want to support things. They don't want to get out the checkbook and write a check and send it. To groups or to organizations, to media groups, that they personally either do not understand, they don't understand these people, so therefore there's going to be no support. They can't stand these people because of what they stand for, so therefore there is still no support. But there's a lot of people that are still sitting on the fence line, saying, well, should I support this or should I not? I know that the gays and lesbians, that they deserve equal rights, but then based on my religious fundamentals, they don't. So you can't stay on the fence too long before you rip your pants.
People reach their own tipping points, and they come to support what they support. Some people are never get involved, and most people in society don't get involved in politics. When a lot of people are involved in politics, you've got a revolutionary situation on your hands. Most people are pretty content to go along with the flow and raise their families and focus on their own issues and get along as best they can. But a lot of people are enthused and excited by the progressive causes or the cutting edge things that need attention. And you say, well, people don't want to write checks, but there are people who do write checks. People who have made the Pride Foundation a multi-million, multi-state charitable organization that is funding arts and health organizations and community building and scholarships for LGBT students of all sorts, and is changing corporate policies and so forth. When I was involved with the Pride Foundation and we had the ability to give away $3,500 in 1 year, that was a pittance compared to the millions of dollars now in the endowment of that organization. That's something that has blossomed and grown over time. And it's going to continue that way because people hear those messages and they want to contribute to it. They don't want to leave their estates to that, something like that, not just to United Way or to Toys for Tots or something. They want to do something for their people and to promote the diversity I've been talking about. And people have stepped forward. They have heard the message. The word is out. It is time to do things and to participate and to give what you can give. And it's fulfilling and it's fun and it's important. I think if there's nothing else I can say to people, it's if you've been discouraged or you've been kind of uncertain or you felt that maybe something isn't quite right, start asking questions. Start asking what's really going on. Ask for someone to give you, what are some options here? Maybe there's something that's needed, new organization, a new effort that you can really wrap yourself around, get yourself into. Nothing wrong with forming a conservative, Christian, gay, friendly, supportive organization. Because there may be very few and far between. There may be a real need for a home base for folks who grow up in that belief structure and who are sincere about it and yet who want to be themselves. There are brothers and sisters, as well as the liberals, the progressives, the Rachel Maddow fans, or whoever that a lot of us are today. They deserve to have their piece of the pie, too. Their own well-crafted personal expression of who they are. And they deserve our respect and our support.
You know, I like to support as many things, Roger, as that I can. And I know that you do too. But you know what, Roger, we are just about out of time for today's show. But hey, I do want to thank you very much for coming on today as our featured guest.
Thank you for letting me talk about this.
You know, folks, Roger, he's a breath of fresh air with a lot of things, because not just did he live back in the days that he's talking about of Stonewall and prior to that, but today, and he has been able in his generation to see things happen, to see things move from where it was, where it was a love that never bore its name, to now people are publicly able to go get married and enjoy family life as a legal entity, as a legal binding family, just like any other. But it's people like Roger and his life that has helped to create what we today are able to enjoy. And Roger, I cannot thank you enough for your help.
Thank you, Roger.
Hey, it's been great, and I will catch you on Facebook-a-roni here pretty soon.
You bet.
All right, Roger, thanks again.
It's an honor.
All right, we'll talk to you real soon. All right, folks. Hey, good friend Roger Winters, and you know I am thrilled. I really am very, very happy to have Roger on for today's show, and I hope that you all enjoyed it. Hey, reminding everybody, mind you, here's my little calendar. If you all want to see the calendar, well, I'm not going to show you the calendar, but I'll tell you what it says. It says that I am officially taking off. Where am I going? Well, the 4th of July is my anniversary. So, the next date that will be on the air will be on the 11th. Hooray, hooray. With Nicholas Wildstar. He is running for the office of governor of the state of California. Interesting gentleman he is. Chef Brandon comes on the 18th. Don't forget that. You know what? We're booked. We've got guests booked into August and looking into September already. And you know what, folks? It's been ridiculous. We've had one ridiculous bout. We have. Just so many things going on. Hey, US Drag, and happy anniversary to you too. In the chat. Lovely. All right, folks. Hey, we hope that you've all enjoyed today's show. Meanwhile, be good to each other. Love each other. Right? And we'll see you next time right here on The Robert Christian Show. So long for now, folks.